Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar Ayyasakarni. The news articles along with the page numbers are displayed here for your reference. The PDF link of the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles is given in the description box as well as in the comment section. Now let us start our today's news analysis. These news articles are with reference to few provisions in the Citizenship Act of 2019. The syllabus relevant for the analysis of these news articles is highlighted here for your reference. So, in this context, we'll be discussing about how the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 is violating secularism, then how it violates right to equality, then how it is violating the right to live with dignity, then how it is having a nexus or connection with the NRC exercise, and we will also discuss why religion is a core and intrinsic identity of an individual. Kindly notice that as of now, there are around some 59 petitions that are filed in the Supreme Court against the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019, and the Supreme Court was expected to hear the petitions today, which is the last working day for the Supreme Court in this year. Because from tomorrow onwards till January 22nd, 2020, it is a winter vacation for the Supreme Court. Kindly notice that today the Supreme Court has not stayed the Citizenship Act of 2019. But it has orally asked the central government to publish the actual intent of the act in the public domain so that there will be no confusion among the public about its objectives. Then the court has also said that the petitions against the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 will be heard next on 22nd January 2020. Now let us come to the news article. The news article alleges that Citizenship Amendment Act violates three things. One is that it violates secularism, then it violates right to equality and dignity of life. Then it has an unholy nexus with the NRC exercise, which means that it negates the purpose of the update of the NRC exercise. Now, we'll see what is a secular nation or a secular state, then how the Citizenship Amendment Act violates secularism. Kindly notice that a secular state is that state which does not favor any particular religion or other religions. We do know that under the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019, only 6 religious communities are mentioned so that they shall not be treated as illegal migrants. And it mentions that any person belonging to these 6 religious communities in 3 neighboring countries shall not be treated as illegal migrants. And these communities are Hindus, Sikhs, Buddhists, Jains, Parsis and Christians. The 3 neighboring countries are Afghanistan, Bangladesh and Pakistan. If these persons have entered into India on or before the 31st of December 2014, they shall not be treated as illegal migrants. The Indian state has favored these 6 religions in 3 countries over other religions and other countries. And this is how this Amendment Act allegedly violates secularism. Then the article mentions that the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 violates right to equality and right to dignity of life. That is right to live with dignity. Kindly notice that right to equality is mentioned as a fundamental right for any person in Article 14 of the Indian Constitution. Then the protection of life and personal liberty comes under Article 21 of the Indian Constitution. Kindly notice that Article 14 of Indian Constitution is available as a fundamental right for both Indian citizens and foreigners. Therefore, the Citizenship Amendment Act allegedly violates right to equality as there is unequal treatment among religious communities in the matter of treatment of illegal migrants. The news article also mentions that it also violates the right to dignity of life. This is because religion of a person is one's own fundamental identity. In fact, as per Supreme Court, it is one of the core and intrinsic identities of an individual. When there is unequal treatment based on the religious identity, this will affect the right to live with dignity of the affected persons. If you see in the case law of Navtej Singh Johar versus Union of India, the constitutional bench of the Supreme Court has mentioned that destruction of individual identity would tantamount to crushing of intrinsic dignity. And religion or race or caste or sex or place of birth are intrinsic and core elements of an individual's identity. Now we'll see that why is religion a core identity of an individual. This is because imagine there is a person who followed Hindu religion at the time of entering into India on or before 31st December 2014, but she or he decides to voluntarily convert to Islam. Now this person is a Hindu while entering into India, but now she or he is a Muslim. And if this person should not be treated as illegal migrant, then she or he should not follow Islam and has to follow one of the six protected religions under the Citizenship Act of 2019. This means that there is no freedom of religion for these persons. While persons of other religions are protected, these persons are not protected. And they cannot live in India like others. This is how the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 violates and affects the right to live with dignity. Now, if you look at the news article, which also mentions that the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 has an unholy nexus or connection with the NRC exercise. Here we have to see in terms of two dimensions. First one is that with reference to the state of Assam, then with respect to the rest of the country. We know that the updated final NRC for Assam state was released on 31st August 2019 and around 19 lakh applicants were excluded in the update process of NRC. Among these excluded persons, there could be persons from several religions, but only six religious communities are not to be treated as illegal migrants and can become Indian citizens by the process of naturalization. This means that the act discriminates the illegal migrants on the basis of religion who are identified by the NRC exercise in the state of Assam. This is one of the examples to highlight the unholy nexus between the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 and the NRC exercise. Now we'll see another example, that is, in future, as per the Home Minister's statements, NRC exercise will be conducted in rest of the country. There have been statements that the entire NRC exercise will be repeated in Assam. And in such future exercises, there will be discrimination among migrants on the basis of religion, as mentioned in the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019. Also, there is fear among poor population of Muslims because they are thinking that even if they have been in India since independence, they could be targeted and harassed more in the future NRC exercise. Then a nationwide exercise will also create fear among the tribal populations who may not be having legal literacy to keep the documents since independence or their copies to substantiate their citizenship. Then there is also fear among some sections of minorities, such as some Christian organizations, and even such Christianity-based organizations have also placed criticism on the Citizenship Amendment Act, and they call that the act is unconstitutional. And this is because Article 14 is violated, as there is a discrimination to one of the religions whose population is minority in India. And this religion is the Muslim religion. And we know that Muslims are notified as minority in India. And Muslims are the only major religious community which was left out of the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019. And if such discriminatory treatment can be made to a religion whose followers are minority in India, a similar situation can happen to any other religious minorities in the future. That is one of the reasons why some sections of the protected religions are also criticizing this Amendment Act of 2019. Then one of the news articles expressed the opinions of the historian, Professor Irfan Habib. He mentions that though the Citizenship Amendment Act excludes the Nepali Hindus or Sri Lanka Tamils or Rohingya Muslims, but the act is basically against those people who are following Islamic faith. So to conclude this news article, we have discussed that how the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 is violating secularism, then how it violated right to equality, then how it has violated right to live with dignity, then the connection with the NRC exercise. And we also discussed why religion is a core and intrinsic identity of an individual. With this, we have come to the end of analysis of these news articles. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of this session. Now, let us proceed to the next news article analysis. This editorial is about the need for structural reforms in India. The author has shared the view of the former finance minister of India that the present government does not understand what structural reforms actually mean. The author suggested that certain incremental reforms as radical structural reforms is need of the hour. Therefore, in this context, we shall be seeing what is meant by an incremental reform and then what is meant by structural reforms. Then we shall be seeing about the political concept of minimal state. And finally, we will also discuss the author's viewpoints on the present status of structural reforms in India. The syllabus that is relevant to the analysis of this editorial is highlighted here for your reference. Now, we'll see about what is meant by incremental reforms. In case of incremental reforms, which involves small adjustments that are needed for the existing policy, and they are likely to improve the performance and the outcomes of the particular policy. But in case of structural reforms, it refers to those reforms which have the potential to change the entire way of working of the institutional and regulatory framework of a country. And these structural reforms can liberate the economy from the control of the government. And it allows the market to work freely by allocating resources on its own. Therefore, in short, structural reforms mean the government shall be out of involving in business activities. So, in this context, the author shares the idea of the classical liberalism of the 19th century. And classical liberalism is a branch of political science. The main economic policy or the economic idea of the classical liberalism is that the state, that is the country, should not intervene in the economy. The country should be a minimal state, which means that the country must involve in maintaining the law and order only. Now, let us see what kind of system that a minimal state will have and the benefits of having such a minimal state. Then the government, which is working towards becoming a minimal state, will start to disinvest its assets, that is, to sell all its assets to the private players. In minimal state, the government will allow private players to own all the economic resources, and it will open up all the sectors in the economy to the private players, and the private can freely buy and sell anything at the market determined prices. So we can say that the concept of minimal state would promote free trade, and people will also be allowed to keep almost everything they have earned from such a free trade. Then instead of government regulations, there will be private contracts between the parties in order to regulate the commercial activities. Now we'll focus on how a minimal state will bring a competition between the private players. And this fair free market competition would ensure that the production of goods and services would rise. When there is a more production, the prices may fall. So this kind of free trade with competition will benefit the consumers. Therefore, as a result of minimal state, the standard of living of the people would increase. So in case of the concept of minimal state, the government's role is minimized in the economic activities and the private will play a major role. And we can also tell this in another way, that a minimal state will enjoy economic freedom. And the ultimate aim of all these activities is to ensure economic prosperity by the country. Then the author tells that because of this concept of minimal state, the countries such as Hong Kong, Singapore have managed to achieve great economic prosperity. The author tells that India has not reached such a stage of minimal state. Then the author tells that the present government promised minimum government and maximum governance. But in the last 5 years, the role of the government in the economy has only increased significantly. Then the author tells that measures such as demonetization and GST have affected the people. But the government has claimed that it has reformed the economy by quoting that the increase in India's ranking in ease of doing business index, which is released by World Bank. Then the author has criticized this by telling that by making small changes to few laws, the government is claiming that it has reformed the economy. The author tells that it is a wrong claim made by the government. Here, The editorial proves this fact by showing the performance of India in the Index of Economic Freedom Ranking. See, this index is released by the Heritage Foundation. The rankings of this index measures the degree to which an economy is market oriented. So in this index, India has been ranked at 129th position out of 180 countries. And this index tells that India is a mostly unfree economy. So we can see that there is a less economic freedom in India. It means that the concept of minimal state is yet to be achieved. The author finally concludes the editorial with a suggestion that economic freedom should become the guiding principle of the government. Only then the genuine structural reforms can be expected in India. Therefore, to summarize this editorial, we have seen what is meant by an incremental reform and then what is meant by structural reform. Then we have seen the concept of minimal state. And finally, we saw the author's views on the present status of the structural reforms in India. So with this, we have come to the end of discussion of this editorial. Have a look at the practice question, which will be discussed at the end of the session. Let us move on to the next news article analysis. This news article speaks about the second annual India Years 2+2 Ministerial Dialogue, which is going to take place today at Washington. So in this context, we'll discuss in brief about the 2+2 dialogue and the expected developments in the India-US bilateral relations. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. If you see 2+2 dialogue, which is considered as the highest level institutional mechanism between India and the US, and that brings together our perspectives on foreign policy, including on defense and strategic issues. Kindly notice that this 2+2 dialogue involves four members, that is two from India, then two from USA. From Indian side, it includes Union External Affairs Minister and Union Defense Minister. And from America, it includes the Secretary of State and the Secretary of Defense. And this dialogue is aimed to provide a positive and forward-looking vision for the India-US strategic partnership. Now, before going to discuss this news article, let us understand the basic foundational agreements of United States of America with other countries. These basic foundational agreements includes GSOMIA, that is General Security of Military Information Agreement, then LIMOVA, that is Logistics Exchange Memorandum of Agreement, then COMCASA, that is the Communications Compatibility and Security Agreement, and then BECA, which is known as the Basic Exchange and Cooperation Agreement for Geospatial Cooperation. You should know that the United States of America has signed the first three agreements, that is GSOMIA, then LIMOVA and COMCASA with India. And India has not yet signed the fourth agreement, that is BECA. All these four agreements have been explained in detail in our 24th November, the Hindu News Analysis video. You can refer the video for your better understanding. So in the context of upcoming meeting, today we'll focus on what could be the hot topics for 2+2 dialogue. If you look at the news article, it has mentioned the enhanced defense cooperation, then furthering the Indo-Pacific strategy, and the discussions on global challenges, including US policy in Iran and Afghanistan, are likely to feature at the top of the agenda. Then on the defense front, the two sides may review steps being taken, that is, to operationalize the one of the foundational agreements, that is Communications Compatibility and Security Agreement. Then there will be discussions on signing the BECA, but it is also expected that India may sign the Industrial Security Annex. Now we will see what is the significance of Industrial Security Annex, that is ISA. Kindly notice that this ISA will be an add-on to the GSOMIA, that is General Security of Military Information Agreement, which was signed between India and the US in 2002. The General Security of Military Information Agreement enables the sharing of military intelligence between the two countries, and it requires each country to protect the other country's classified information. So the Industrial Security Annex would enable closer defense industry cooperation and collaboration between the two nations. It means that the ISA is critical for US defense companies which are bidding to deal with Indian private industry. Therefore, ISA would further enable transfer of key high-end technology from US defense companies to its Indian partners. So this will make the state of the art defense technology available to Indian defense companies. Therefore, the industrial security annex will give a boost to the Indian private sector who are looking for a greater role in defense manufacturing in India. So in the context of 2+2 dialogue, now we'll see other dialogues which are expected to be concluded, which includes the purchasing of about 114 fighter jets by Indian Air Force, then other big ticket defense deals like Seahawk multi-role helicopter, then purchasing of naval gun systems. Now, if you look at the news article, which says that during the dialogue, a standard operating procedure for Defense Technology Trade Initiative, that is DTTI, is also expected to be signed. Kindly notice that this DTTI is a mechanism between India and US to speed up the scope of cooperation on defense technology. This means that it would prioritize co-production and co-development of projects between the two nations. Now, we'll see about CARSA, which is Countering America's Adversaries Through Sanctions Act. Kindly notice that America is targeting Iran, Russia and North Korea through sanctions under CARSA. And CARSA aims to deter significant transactions with these three countries. So in this context, India might be seeking a temporary waiver from the sanctions so that India can import oil from Iran and also for S-400 missile deal with Russia. Then another potential issue which is mentioned in the news article is that the future developments in the Indo-Pacific and evolving cooperation between the Quad. We know that Quad, or the Quadrilateral Security Dialogue, is an informal grouping between India, America and Japan and Australia. And Quad aims to keep the sea routes in the Indo-Pacific region free of any influence. Therefore, as per the news article, the US may push for more military engagement within the quadrilateral grouping. Then the news article also says that US officials had raised concerns over the Citizenship Amendment Act of 2019 and the following protest in the country and the continuing restrictions and detention of leaders in Kashmir, and this could also be a potential talk during the 2+2 dialogue. So, to conclude this news article, the ongoing 2+2 dialogue could resolve the existing differences between India and America and take the strategic partnership to a new level. Now, let us proceed to the next news article analysis. The news article is related to the number of capitals for the state of Andhra Pradesh. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Kindly notice that Andhra was the first state to form on linguistic basis after independence. In 1953, the state of Andhra was formed comprising of the Telugu speaking portion of the then Madras province. At that time, the capital of Andhra state was the historic city of Kurnool. Then later the name was changed to Andhra Pradesh and the capital was shifted to Hyderabad in 1956. But in 2014, Andhra Pradesh Reorganization Act was passed by the parliament, which bifurcated the state of United Andhra Pradesh into the state of Telangana and the state of Andhra Pradesh. Then the Section 5 of the 2014 Reorganization Act says that Hyderabad shall be the common capital of the state of Telangana and the state of Andhra Pradesh for such period not exceeding 10 years. Then after 10 years, Hyderabad shall become the capital of the state of Telangana and there shall be a new capital for the state of Andhra Pradesh. Therefore, the news article can be seen in this background. Kindly notice that earlier there were speculations that Andhra Pradesh will have a common capital or single capital at Amaravati. But now the present Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh has proposed three capital cities for the state of Andhra Pradesh. And the proposed capitals are Amaravati as the legislative capital, then the port city of Visakhapatnam as the executive capital, then the historical city of Kurnool as the judicial capital as shown in the figure. If you look at the news article, the Chief Minister of Andhra Pradesh has said that this would be on the lines of the Republic of South Africa. Kindly notice that Republic of South Africa has three capitals, that is Pretoria as the administrative or executive capital, then Bloemfontein as the judicial capital, and the Cape Town as the legislative capital. The reason for three capitals for Republic of South Africa were partly political and partly cultural. In 1910, when the Union of South Africa was formed, there was a great dispute about the location of the new country's capital city. Then a compromise was reached to spread a balance of power throughout the country. And this has led to the current capital cities, which are located across the country as shown in the figure. Now let us discuss the advantages and disadvantages of having more than one capital. Kindly notice that a capital of the state enjoys primary status and the development will be more focused on this city. Therefore, for a larger state like Andhra Pradesh, having three capitals spreading all over the state will be more accommodative. Then we will see why is it important politically. Because we have been long hearing the demand for a separate statehood for Rayalaseema. And Rayalaseema is the southwestern part of Andhra Pradesh. And as per some sources, Rayalaseema is one of the backward regions in terms of resources and infrastructure. Therefore, accommodating Kurnool, that is located in Rayalaseema, would accommodate the people of this region. Therefore, it might put an end to the demand for a separate state. And this would ensure political stability in the state of Andhra Pradesh. Now, we will see why is it important economically. If you look at the news article, which says that developing a grand capital city at Amaravati is estimated to cost more than 1 lakh crore. This is a huge amount considering the fact that Andhra Pradesh has lost one of its largest revenue generating district, that is Hyderabad, to the state of Telangana. Therefore, a well-planned and distributed development of these three capitals can actually bring down the overall cost for the state of Andhra Pradesh. For example, the port city of Visakhapatnam, which has good infrastructure, can be converted into one of the capitals with minimum investment. Therefore, it can save the total amount that is required for the establishment of executive capital. And the saved amount can be diverted into other welfare plans of the state. As a result, having three capitals for the state of Andhra Pradesh would decentralize the authority and could develop the entire region. But there are some drawbacks with respect to having three capitals for the state of Andhra Pradesh. Because earlier there were criticisms that party members of the former ruling party of Andhra Pradesh had brought huge tracts of land in Amaravati because of the speculation that it would be the capital. And such kind of actions is even possible in the present scenario. Therefore, the present government must make sure that such events will not happen. Then one of the major disadvantages is that ensuring accessibility of all the three capitals for the people from all the regions of the state is also a big task. Then to have effective coordination among legislative, then executive and judiciary is also a challenging task if there are three capitals. With this information, we have come to the end of analysis of this news article. The displayed practice question will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us proceed to the next news article. This news article is about the decision of TRAI, that is Telecom Authority of India, related to interconnection usage charges. In this news article, we shall be discussing in brief about IUC, then about the decision by TRAI, which has been discussed in the news article. Then we shall also be seeing about adjusted gross revenue, which is related to the telecom companies. The syllabus relevant to the analysis of this news article is highlighted here for your reference. Now, we'll start with interconnection usage charges. Before that, let us see an example. For example, two persons are doing a small business and both of them are having Jio company SIM. They are using the Jio network to make calls between each other and they also use Jio messaging services. So, we can tell that here Jio is the service provider that connects both these persons with its network and equipments. Now, consider one more person who is joining this business, but he is having an Airtel SIM. Here, an arrangement called interconnection is used. Under this arrangement, one telecom service provider connects their equipment, networks and services with other telecom service providers. Now, consider the person using Jio SIM is making a call to the person who is using Airtel SIM. The person who uses the Jio SIM is the one who originates the call. And the person who is with Airtel SIM attends the call is the person who terminates the call. Therefore, in this case, there is an interconnection of Airtel service providing network with Jio service providing network. So, there is a charge involved in this interconnection process. This charge is called as the interconnection usage charges or IUC. Thus, we can also define the interconnection usage charge as charge payable by a service provider whose subscriber originates the call to the service provider in whose network the call terminates. It means when a person originates a call, he has to pay his network provider. The network provider will pay the interconnection usage charges to the network to which the call was placed. This is also called the bill and keep regime or net payment zero regime. We have discussed about this issue in detail in our 16th October 2019, the Hindu News Analysis video. You can refer this video for your better understanding. During that day, we also saw that the present process of collecting interconnection usage charges will be stopped from 1st January 2020. This means each network will have to agree to terminate calls from other network at no charges. But today's news article mentions that there will be no interconnection usage charges from 1st January 2021 onwards. So we can see that the status quo has been extended by one more year. So the existing procedure of collecting IUC continued till 31st December 2020. And this is considered as a huge relief for major telecom players like Vodafone Idea and Bharati Airtel. Troy has given some reasons in this regard. Then if you see, only Jio is largely benefited in the market because it has a large market share. Troy has told that retaining the IUC will act as a level playing field for companies such as Airtel and Vodafone Idea. And it will also help the market to remain competitive. Further, Troy has noted that telecom sector is a capital intensive sector. It has a long gestation period, meaning it will take years for a company to make profits. So the entry of new service providers in the short run was very difficult. It means that the existing service providers have to continue their business. These are some of the reasons why Troy has extended the status quo for one more year. So you can see that because of the large market share of Jio, other telecom companies like Airtel and Vodafone Idea are very much affected. In addition, both these companies are also hugely affected because of the recent decision of the Supreme Court on the definition of the adjusted gross revenue. Now we'll see about AGR, that is adjusted gross revenue, which means that the gross revenue of a telecom company after some specific deductions. This amount is taxable by the government. Kindly notice that on 24th October, the Supreme Court delivered a judgment on what are the constraints of AGR. This judgment affected the major telecom operators like Airtel and Vodafone Idea. Because of this judgment, now they have to pay an estimated amount of 1,40,000 crores to the government. So revenue from IUC is actually a benefit for both these telecom companies. We have also discussed more on this AGR issue in our 3rd November news analysis. Please have a look at it for further subject clarity. So whenever you read news articles about any particular sector, for example telecom sector, try to connect all the news articles that have appeared for the first few months so that you will get an overall idea of what is happening and what are the issues of that particular sector. Now, look at the news article which says that Troy had also released a consultation paper. In this consultation paper, Troy had sought the views of stakeholders in telecom industry in order to fix a minimum tariff for mobile voice calls and data services. And it is an evolving news article. We'll be getting more news articles on this topic by the end of January, and we'll be discussing more on this topic in the coming days. Now we'll see in brief about TRAI, which is the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India, which was established in 1997 by an Act of Parliament called the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India Act 1997. TRAI function is to regulate telecom services, including fixation or revision of tariffs for telecom services. Then one of the main objectives of TRAI is to provide a fair and transparent policy environment which promotes a level playing field and to facilitate fair competition in the market. Therefore, to summarize this news article, we have seen in brief about interconnection usage charges, then about the decision by TRAI to extend the present collection of IUC, then we also saw in brief about the adjusted gross revenue, and finally we have seen about TRAI. Have a look at the practice question which will be discussed at the end of the session. Now let us start our practice question session. Now, look at this question. This question is with reference to the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India. And they have given three statements and you have to choose the incorrect statements using the codes given below. Statement one says that it has been established by an executive order of the Government of India. Then second statement says that one of the main objectives of TRAI is to provide a fair and transparent policy environment which promotes a level playing field and to facilitate fair competition. Then third statement says that interconnection usage charges, which is often seen in news, is regulated by TRAI. Kindly notice that TRAI was established in 1997 by an act of parliament, that is the Telecom Regulatory Authority of India Act 1997. So therefore TRAI is a statutory body. So first statement is incorrect. Then the function of TRAI is to regulate telecom services, including fixation or revision of tariffs for telecom services. Then one of the main objectives of TRAI is to provide a fair and transparent policy environment which promotes a level playing field and to facilitate fair competition. So second statement, which says that one of the main objectives of TRAI is to provide fair and transparent policy environment, is correct statement. Now if you look at the third statement, which says that IUC, which is often seen in news, is regulated by TRAI, this statement is correct because it is also regulated by TRAI. Kindly notice that IUC is a charge payable by a service provider whose subscriber originates the call to the service provider in whose network the call terminates. It means when a person originates a call, he has to pay his network provider. The network provider will pay the interconnection charges to the network to which the call was placed. And this IUC is also known as the bill and keep regime or net payment zero regime. The recent news is that the process of collecting IUC has been extended till 31st December 2020 by TRAI. So the given third statement is also correct. But for this question, you have to choose the incorrect statements. So option A, that is one only, is the correct option for this question. Now look at this question. They have given two statements and you have to choose the correct statements. Statement 1 says that Andhra is the first state in pre-independent India to form on a linguistic basis. Then the second statement says that the present state of Andhra Pradesh shares border with Odisha, Chhattisgarh, then Telangana, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. Kindly notice that the state of Andhra was the first state to form on a linguistic basis in independent India. That is, in 1953, the state of Andhra was formed comprising of the Telugu speaking portion of the then Madras province. Then you should know that the province of Odisha was the first to form on a linguistic basis before the independence. Therefore, first statement is incorrect statement. Then the second statement says that the present state of Andhra Pradesh shares border with Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Telangana, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. The second statement is correct because if you look at the map, the states like Odisha, Chhattisgarh, Telangana, Karnataka and Tamil Nadu share border with the state of present Andhra Pradesh. Therefore, for this question, option B, 2 only, is the correct option. Now, consider this question. They have given countries like Zambia, Namibia, Botswana, Zimbabwe, Lesotho, then Mozambique. Then they are asking the countries which share border with South Africa. For this question, if you look at the map, you can see that the countries like Mozambique, Zimbabwe, Botswana, Namibia, Lesotho, Swaziland share border with the Republic of South Africa. Therefore, except Zambia, remaining all the countries given are sharing border with the Republic of South Africa. So option D, that is 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 is the correct option for this question. Now, look at this question. This question is based on part 3 of Indian Constitution. They have given two statements and you have to choose the correct answer from the quotes given. Statement 1 says that subject to public order, morality and health and to the other provisions of this part, all persons are equally entitled to freedom of conscience and the right to freely profess, practice and propagate religion. This statement is correct because as per Article 25 Clause 1, which says that subject to public order, morality and health and to the other provisions of this part, all persons are equally entitled to freedom of conscience and the right to freely profess, practice and propagate religion. Then look at the second statement, which says that the state shall not deny to any person equality before law or the equal protection of the laws within the territory of India. This statement is also correct because as per the Article 14, which says that the state shall not deny to any person equality before law or the equal protection of the laws within the territory of India. So for this question, option C, that is both 1 and 2, is the correct option. Now look at this practice mains question. The question says economic freedom should be the guiding principle of a nation's policy making. In the context of the above statement, explain what is minimal state. Suggest some suitable measures for India to achieve economic freedom. So for this question, you can post your written answers in the comment section in 150 words and it is a 10 marks question. The posted answers would be evaluated and suitable feedback or guidance will be given to the posted answers. With this, we have come to the end of the today's Indian news analysis. If you like the video, please do like, share, comment and subscribe Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates. Thank you.